Soon, church, we're going to be in His presence, surrounded by His glory. We're here in His presence this morning, but we'll see Him face to face. Does that excite you? That is my desire, my heart's desire. I love you all, and it's good to see you now and again, and you know, we have fellowship, and you know, there's a lot of things upon this earth that I enjoy. But I'll give it up in a heartbeat to stand in His holy presence. Praise God. We're going to dismiss our children to Children's Church at this time. Make sure you learn something, kids. Tell your teacher, I want to know about Jesus. Praise God. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to turn with me in the book of Matthew to chapter 7. When you get there, would you mind standing with me as we honor the reading of God's Word? If you don't have a Bible, that's fine. Then listen along as we read. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. Jesus said, "Enter ye in at the strait gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because strait is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." Father, I thank you for your word. I know, God, that it is eternal. Lord, it will never pass away. Heaven and earth will pass away, but your word will remain forever. Father, I also know that you are aware of who is here today. You knew from the foundation of the world who would be here today. You also knew, Lord, exactly in your sovereignty what would be spoken today. Father, I just pray that you will speak to the hearts of people, that those that need to hear will hear what they need to hear, Father, and that it will do the work that you have intended it. Lord, I know that your word will never return void. Father, I pray for your anointing this morning because my words are nothing. Nothing I say could change a life. Nothing I say, God, has any eternal significance. Only by your Spirit. So we rely upon you. God, please move in this place. Let your perfect will be done. And we will give you the glory and the honor. For we ask it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Today is Sanctity of Life Sunday. The title of my message is Sanctity of Life. It is Sanctity of Life Sunday. This day has been set aside to focus on the value of human life. This day was set aside to resist the onslaught of the pro-choice movement. Now, I ask you to hear what I have to say this morning. I firmly believe in every woman, that every woman has a right to choose what she wants to do with her own body. I believe that with all my heart, just as long as it doesn't harm the little child within that's being formed there. Because I think that little person has a choice too. You could say amen if you believe that. I believe that. I won't say much more about this subject today other than this. You want to know why there are mass murders in the world. You wonder why there are shootings in the street, gang warfare, people killing each other. You want to know why you could die over a ham sandwich on any street corner in America. You want to know why life is cheapened and it has no value. And I'll tell you, in a large measure, it has to do with the pro-choice movement. Life is meaningless. in or out of the womb. Life, it's cheapened. And so we see a lot of things happen in the world as a result of this. Let me just ask you this question, and then I'll move on, I promise you. Who hates human life more than anyone else? Who hates God's creation more than anyone else? Who is bent, hell-bent on destroying everything that God ever created, including human life?
Satan.
I don't think I have to say anymore. The origin, where this hellish law was birthed. And now I'll move on. There may very well be, as I know, as I've a congregation, I know we're small in number, but a congregation this size, I know that there may very well be some here who have had abortions in their past, and I just want to assure you that there is no sin so great that God can't forgive. There is no sin so great that God's grace can't reach it. In fact, the sins of my past are just as ugly. In fact, the sins of all of our past are just as ugly as this. So nobody could point a finger at anybody else and accuse someone of what they did when we ourselves are filthy, rotten, dirty sinners, as Ralph said this morning, all in need of a Savior. But the good news is that Jesus has taken our sin and he's cast it into the sea of God's forgetfulness. For those who've come to him in Christ, your sin, my sin, all of it, thrown into God's sea of forgetfulness, and he said that our sin is separated from us as far as the east is from the west. That's infinity. And so whatever you have done, regardless of your sin, it's washed away in the blood of Christ if you have come to God through Christ Jesus. Now I want to bring attention to the biblical view of life this morning. This is, we know the world's view of life, but I want to talk to you about the biblical view of life this morning. Jesus said that he has come that we might have life, and that we might have it more abundantly, John 10:10. Now I know what the prosperity teachers have done with this text, and I just want to tell you that it's there for a reason. Jesus said, this is the reason that I came. I have come that you might have life, and that you might have life in abundance. Not abundance of things, but abundance of life.
Amen.
The word sanctity, in Noah Webster's dictionary, the word sanctity is defined as this: holiness, the state of being sacred or holy, sacredness. That's what I want to talk to you about this morning. The sacredness, the holiness of human life. Life, friends, itself is a gift from God. And in fact, in Acts chapter 3, verse 15, Peter there, he says that Jesus is the Prince of Life. The Prince. That word in the Greek language, the original, Prince, Argikos, it means originator, founder, author. Jesus Christ is the author of life, the founder of life, the originator, the creator of life, the Alpha and the Omega of life. He's the one who invented life and who has given it as a free gift. And so we know that he is the Prince and the creator of life. Genesis 1:27, the Bible says, God created man in his own image. Now, we could debate this morning as to what image, whether that means a physical image. I don't believe that we are made in the physical image of God, but that's fine if you do. I believe this is more of a moral and spiritual image, but regardless, and we could debate if you wanted to, but I think we'll all agree on this, that whatever, in whichever image that is, that God has created us, that man might be holy and of moral integrity. Would you agree with me on that? In fact, in Leviticus, God says, be ye holy, for I am holy. And in fact, he said, the Bible says that without holiness, no man could see God. Nobody could see God. If we're not holy, how could we see a holy God? Now, in fact, The Bible says, what fellowship has light with darkness? What fellowship does holiness have with unholiness? I know that's not a popular word in 2013. Holiness. Oh, you're one of them. Holiness preachers. Yeah, I guess I am. But it's in the Bible, and if God said it, I guess it's probably true that if we don't have holiness, we won't see Him, and He's holy, and so we must be holy. And how could a holy God associate Himself with unholiness? He can't. Friends, our only hope, therefore, is to come through Jesus Christ, to come through Him. In fact, the Bible says that that He has given us. Hebrews says that we are partakers of His holiness. See, our own works are insufficient. There's nothing that we can do. You can shower, bathe, and I hope you do. Really hope you did. But you could scrub yourself until you bleed. Nothing we can do is going to make us holy enough to be in His presence. Only when we come to Christ and He instills and He puts within us and he makes us partakers of His holiness can we stand before a holy God. You quiet this morning? You're quiet this morning. You okay? Everybody all right? Jesus said that we must enter the gate that is narrow. Enter the gate of life. And that's what I want to talk about. And I'll be brief this morning. As brief as I know how to be. The gate of life. We're to enter in at the gate of life. Jesus said, enter ye in. Enter ye in. The word enter is written in the aorist tense, imperative voice in the Greek language. You say, Pastor, we don't care. This ain't a grammar language this morning. Okay, cool. I got one or two people that care. This ain't a grammar study this morning, Pastor, but would you agree with me that how we say something is often just as important as what we say? All right, so for instance, and I'll be as creative as I can be this morning, but if I said to you, go to church, it's a question. If I said to you, go to church, that's a suggestion. If I said to you, go to church, it's a command, right? So how we say something may be and often is just as important as what we say. And so I want to look at how this was written. It was written in the imperative voice. Imperative means not to be avoided or evaded. Jesus spoke this in the imperative voice when He said, enter ye in. Imperative. It means that it's not to be avoided. It's not to be evaded. He spoke it in the aorist tense, which means at once and without delay. So Jesus is saying, you must immediately, without delay, do not avoid, right now, enter in to the gate of life. Enter ye in. It is imperative that you do this at once and without delay. Show immediate energy and determination to enter in. You still with me? In Luke's gospel in chapter 13, verses 22 through 25, this is Luke's account of the same incident. And he went through the cities and villages, teaching and journeying towards Jerusalem. Then said one unto him, Lord, are there few that be saved? And he said unto them, strive to enter in at the strait gate. For many, I say unto you, will seek to enter in and shall not be able. When once the master of the house is risen up and hath shut to the door, and you begin to stand without and to knock at the door, saying, Lord, Lord, open unto us. And he shall answer and say unto you, I know you not whence you are. Jesus is saying, he said to his disciples, he said to the crowd, he's saying to us this morning and to all who will listen, he's saying, enter in, strive to enter into the straight gate. Now that word straight, S-T-R-A-I-T, it's like the Strait of Gibraltar, the Strait of Hormuz, the Strait, it means a narrow passage. It means that the passage was perhaps at one time wide, but it has narrowed and it has become a strait. It's become a narrow channel or a narrow place. And Jesus is saying to strive to enter in at that narrow place. And the word that he uses, to strive, is in the present imperative. If you're taking notes. In the present imperative. Strive. Imperative, again, it means immediately, it means it's an absolute must. And so this word strive in the present imperative means to fight, to struggle, to agonize. And in actuality, the word strive in Greek is agozinomai, or agonize, where we get the word agonize from. And Jesus is saying to literally strive, to struggle, to fight, to agonize, to get into the straight gate. Is the point becoming clear, or is it clear?
Amen.
Have I beat the horse senseless over here? It is imperative at once that you strive and fight to enter in to the narrow gate. He's telling us it is imperative to do this. Present tense, always keep on striving. And so not only must you do this at once, not only must you do this, but you must do this continually, constantly striving and fighting that you might enter in to the narrow gate. We've made some good ground. I've been here 9 years. I know most of you fairly well. Some of you are new. Some of you I've never met before. But those that I know, I know your lives, some of them, and I know that you have striven, and I know that you've made ground. You know, we've pressed on, and we've matured in these 9 years. We've gone farther than we were 9 years ago, hopefully, for most of us. But I'm reminded of this. I'm reminded of the story I read in World War II, where the Allied troops were pressing through Europe, and they came to a particular place, and they stopped as they before they went into Eastern Europe. They stopped. Now, I'm a conspiracy theorist, and I'd be happy to tell you why later. But they stopped there, and they left it for the Russians to take Eastern Europe. The Allied troops stopped. They were progressing. They were mighty. They were on a roll. And they just stopped and allowed Russia to go in and take Eastern Europe. And Russia has been a threat ever since. USSR and the like. And we've had to deal with them because we, as the Allied troops, did not press in and take all of Europe. The first Gulf War, some of you are old enough to remember, we left Saddam Hussein in power. And he just rose up again to create havoc. And we had to deal with him then. In 1 Samuel, King Saul, God told Saul, go in and destroy the Amalekites. Totally, completely, and absolutely wipe them out. Don't leave anything alive. And Saul went in and he kept Agag, the king, alive. And they were a sword in the side of Israel thereafter. What I'm saying is this. We must strive. We must keep on striving, pressing on in to enter in at the gate that is narrow. You with me?
Amen.
Now, lest you hear something that I haven't said. Jesus isn't saying, nor am I this morning, saying that we can fight and struggle and strive and work our way into heaven. That's an impossibility. Because the very best that we have, our greatest efforts, are tainted by sin, polluted by sin. And so there's absolutely nothing that we could do to earn our salvation. When he says to strive and struggle and fight and work towards this, he's not saying that that's how we get in. That's not, that's the access point. No, the Bible makes it very clear that our salvation is by grace. Grace, friends, is unmerited favor. Grace is unearned. And in fact, that's what makes it grace. There's nothing we did or could do to receive it. That's what makes it grace. It's unmerited, unearned favor from God. And we receive it by faith, through faith. We lay hold upon that. And we believe what God has done, and we take hold of it by faith. And faith is a gift from God. Lest any of us boast and say, well, I have earned, I'm good enough, I've worked my way, I've fought my way through to receive salvation, and I'm here because of my own. No, none of us can do that. So please don't misunderstand what I'm saying. Salvation is through grace, by faith, and that is a gift of God, lest any should boast. But here's what I'm saying, because Jesus said it. Look, if we accept good enough, you know, I hear all the time, that's good enough. Good enough for government work. Can't see it from my house. Good enough. When I was in FedEx, there was a sign, a poster that was posted everywhere. Good enough, the enemy of excellence. Whenever we say, well, that's good enough, we are no longer striving for excellence. I'm not talking about perfection. I'm talking about excellence. About giving it your best and receiving the best and doing the best. Don't fall to mediocrity this morning. You still there?
Amen.
Don't fall to mediocrity. If we are to accept good enough, how about 99.9%?
No.
Praise God, from the mouth of babes, hallelujah. There's hope. There's hope for the church. Praise God. 99.9% good enough? If 99.9% is good enough, then we have to accept 1 hour of unsafe drinking water every month. I don't know what hour that will be. Don't worry about it. It's good enough. 2 unsafe plane landings at Chicago's O'Hare Airport daily. Now, that's okay if you don't fly in and out of O'Hare. Don't worry about it. And, you know, only 2 planes, you know, a day. I guess don't worry about it. 16,000 pieces of mail will be lost every hour, but that's okay. 20,000 incorrect drug prescriptions, 20,000 every year. When you go to the drugstore and you get that prescription and you take those pills, they could kill you 20,000 times, but don't worry about it. Probably not going to happen to you. 500 incorrect surgical operations every week. They remove the wrong leg or something. 50 newborn babies dropped at birth every day. Would explain a lot. 22,000 checks deducted from the wrong bank hourly, if 99.9% is okay. 32,000 missed heartbeats per person per year. 32,000. Now, if they're all together, you got a problem. How many miles would the Apollo mission have missed the moon by, if 99.9%? More importantly, by how many miles would the Apollo mission have missed the Earth if 99.9% was sufficient? Do you get the point here? We've not arrived. The straight gate, it's there and it's ahead of us, but we haven't gone through it yet. And so we haven't arrived, friends. We can't settle for mediocrity. Don't settle for mediocrity. Press on. Jesus said you got to strive immediately. It's imperative. And keep on striving. Keep on struggling. Keep on fighting. Why? Not so that you can be saved, get saved, but because all hell is against us.
Amen.
Because there are forces on every side of us that are clamoring for our attention and trying to get us sidetracked so that we won't reach the excellence that God has in store for us. If there's anything he could do to trip us up, he will. And so we must strive and struggle and fight to keep on the narrow road. There's a goal in mind. Don't settle for less. Don't settle for anything less. Paul said in Philippians chapter 3, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." Listen to this man of God, to this apostle of Jesus Christ who said, I've not arrived. He said, everything behind me. In fact, in another place he said, I count it dung. It's on the garbage heap. It's in the sewer. All of his victories, all the miracles that were done in his life, all of the great things that he had seen, all of his failures and all of his sin and everything, he said, it's all behind me. And he can sum up his life with this. This one thing I do, I'm pressing on for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. The picture here is of a runner in full stride, reaching in every step for that extra inch that he might run the race to win. This is the picture here that Paul paints. This is the picture here that Jesus gives us. Strive to enter in. I know I've shared with you a couple of times. I'll say it again for those who care or for those who haven't heard it before. But when I was in basic training in the Army, Fort Knox, Kentucky, I had two of the meanest, nastiest drill sergeants they ever dug up from wherever they dug them up. These guys were cold-hearted and vicious. And, you know, we ran more. That we would get up earlier than the rest of the battalion, and we'd be running. They'd be sleeping. And we'd show up at the chow line, and, you know, we just ran 2 or 3 miles. We're tired already. It's 6 o'clock in the morning. You know, we can't stand. It's still dark. And you know, we're falling out of formation, and drill sergeant would make us do push-ups in front of the rest of the battalion. And they're all laughing at us constantly. We looked like misfits. There's nothing. We were always in trouble. There was nothing we did right. Everything had to be, you know, we had to redo it, and just they were just nasty. Until the day of graduation. And we had to go to the confidence course. And we found that we could run faster and jump higher and climb quicker. And we excelled. We blasted right past everybody else in line. We were excellent when it mattered. Because we weren't allowed to accept mediocrity. We weren't allowed to cut corners. We pressed on towards the mark for the prize. Friends, we got to press on for when it really matters, when we stand before Him, when we enter that narrow gate. Don't settle for less. We are living in desperate times. Can I tell you that? These are desperate times. Truth is at a premium. We have politicians that speak out of both sides of their mouths. Doesn't matter what party. Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. And now there are some good politicians. Don't get me wrong. I don't believe they're all liars. But you know what I'm talking about. Oh, we'll do this and I'll do that. Just elect me. And it never happens. Truth, friends, is at a premium. Athletes having long-time relationships with women that don't exist. I'd like you to meet my best friend, Frankie. I keep him around because he makes me look good. Or other athletes winning great medals, great feats. And, you know, how dare you insinuate that I was cheating, only to find out that he was cheating all along. I'm just telling you, truth is at a premium. We live in desperate times. Preachers that are preaching doctrines of devils. Men who once stood and preached the gospel, who have abandoned the truth of the gospel and are now preaching doctrines of devils. I've come to this. There are very few people that I will stand to defend anymore. I got to be honest with you. I defended Tour de France. What's his name? Lance. I defended him to people. It can't be possible. It's not possible. No. Yeah. Well, I'm careful now. I don't know who I could defend because we live in desperate times and truth is at a premium. Listen, the Bible tells us, Jesus said that broad is the way that leads to destruction. Broad is the way. That's wide. And narrow is the road that leads to life. But that was 2,000 years ago. This was 2,000 years ago that he said the road was narrow. Guess what? It's still narrow. And it always will be narrow. Now, I understand that there are many demolition crews out there trying to broaden the road. You ever see them broaden the roads when towns or cities begin to grow and the traffic begins to increase? What they do? They come in with the bulldozers and they rip up the curb. That's usually the first to go, the curb, the boundary. So they remove the boundaries of the old road. They tear up the boundaries. And then they move the utility poles out further. And then they move the signs out further, and they plant new shrubbery trees and what have you outside. They push that out further, and then they pave, and then they put down the new line down the middle. And you look at it and you say, "Wow, that's beautiful." The road is, and if you're there for a while, you tend to forget how narrow the road once was. You become accustomed to to the new narrow, and you forget just where the boundaries were. And if you happen to be a new resident in town, or if you're born into this town now with that road, then that is the way it's always been. And you just grow up with this, that is the narrow road, and you never really knew how narrow the road was intended to be. Do you follow me? There are a lot of demolition crews out there attempting to make the road less narrow. But friends, it's still just as narrow, and it always will be as narrow as Christ has said it should be. And Jesus said, strive to enter there. Strive to enter. The word narrow means pressing, squeezing. A new word for some of you, extruding. You know what an extruder is? You know what an extruder is. You've all played with one. The Play-Doh machine. You take that chunk of Play-Doh and you throw it in the machine and you pull the handle and it squeezes that dough through that little shape and it squeezes out. It's taken all that dough and it squeezes it out into a narrow passage and it takes on the shape that it's intended to take on, right? It's being extruded. It's being forced through a narrow channel. Do you remember also that the colder the dough was, the harder it was to extrude, right? It had to get warmed up. It had to get heated up before you could really squish it through there. Just draw your own conclusion to that. But we are to be conformed into the image of Christ. We are to, it's a narrow road and we're to go through the narrow gate. And the end result is to take on the form and image of Christ. Amen. To be formed in fashion, to be extruded into the image of the Son of God. Now listen to me. You may call me narrow-minded this morning. Thank you. If I'm narrow-minded, that is a compliment. Because the road, Jesus said, is narrow, and the gate is narrow, and we're to continue down that road and enter into that gate. Secondly and lastly, only 2 points. Bet you're glad I had at least one. The goal of life. Existence is not life. I mean, perhaps biologically it is. You could fog a mirror, and so you're alive. I guess there's a pulse, that's life. And biologically, science would say you have life, you're alive. And that may be true in science, but friends, I know people that exist that have no life. Do you know, they exist, they get up in the morning, they shower, they eat their breakfast, they brush their teeth, they put on their clothes, they get in the car, they drive to work. They go through their day, they come home, they change, they eat, they sleep, watch TV, whatever it is they do. And they do this every single day. And there's no life. Do you know what I'm talking about? Nothing that you would classify as real life. Certainly not the abundant life that Christ intended for us to live. So existence, fogging a mirror, is not life. I ask you this morning, and we're almost at the end, when was the last time you wept for joy? When was the last time you just said, you just wept, you were just so overwhelmed with joy that you just sat and wept? When was the last time you let go a really deep belly laugh? You know, where your sides ached and the tears flowed down your face because you were just laughing. You were just, when was the last time you had that overwhelming sense of well-being? When you just sat there maybe gazing out at the sunset and said, It's okay. Maybe there were a lot of problems. Maybe there were a lot of difficulties. I don't know anybody who doesn't have any. But you had that overwhelming sense of well-being. It's okay. It's well with my soul. Jesus said, I tell you the truth. Whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. I got to say that again. Jesus said, I tell you the truth. Whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. Colossians 3:4, Paul says that Christ is our life. Christ is our life is in him. It comes from him. Remember, he is the Prince of Life, the author, the originator of life. But you sit here this morning, you might be listening, and you don't have that life. You don't have this kind of life I'm talking about. Maybe you're miserable. Maybe things aren't working out the way you wanted them to, and you have to say, I don't know what you're talking about. I haven't had joy in years. I don't know a sense of well-being. I haven't laughed. I don't even know what it is you're talking about. Maybe you sit here this morning or you listen on TV and you say there's a sense of guilt. I've done things that I'm ashamed of, and I feel the guilt of it. I feel the shame of it, and maybe that eats away at you. I don't know. God knows. God knows where you've been. He knows what you've... He knows it all. He knows. The Bible says he knows the number of hairs on your head. He knows your thoughts before you even think them. Before the world was ever created, he knew you. He knows your end, just as he knows your beginning. And he loves you. He loves us. The Bible says that he loves us. Friends, I can't explain that. I don't understand. I wouldn't love me if I were God. But he loves me, and he loves you, and he's promised to, but he won't tolerate our lack of repentance, our lack of turning from sin. He won't accept that. He won't tolerate that. You know, I find that a lot of people, you know, like the prison house conversion, people will confess, and they'll come clean when they're caught. You ever notice that? Kids do it, but adults do it as well. Come on, we all do it. We'll come clean once we're caught. Consider yourself caught. In fact, we live caught. We live our lives exposed to God, who knows not only what we think, but why we think it. And so consider yourself this morning caught. God knows. You're exposed before him. But he loves you still. See, friends, that's what conviction is all about as I close. That's what conviction is all about. And people try everything to avoid conviction. I don't want to hear it. Don't tell me. Let me remain ignorant. People don't want to come under that conviction. Conviction is uncomfortable, isn't it? It's uncomfortable. You feel the guilt of what you do. You know you're wrong. People try and avoid that. But that uneasiness is God speaking to us, trying to tell us that there's something he wants us to do, something he wants to change. He wants to forgive us. He wants to help us to go down that road a little further. So conviction comes, friends. Don't fight it. Don't resist it. Give in. Get it right. Go to an altar. Try it. Go back in your mind for just a moment to the day when you first gave your life to Christ, for those of you who have. Just go back to that moment. What was happening? What was going on in your life at that time? What took place? Was there a zeal? Were you excited? I remember I was a fool. I was just a little nut when Christ forgave me, and I realized that I had a clean slate. Do you remember? Maybe you were quiet. Maybe you jumped up and down. I don't know. But do you remember? Was there a desire in your heart? Did you make any promises? Oh, God, thank you. I'll give you my life. I'm so happy that you saved me. I'll do anything in the world. I'll live my life for you. Did you make any of those promises? Because, you know, maybe we have a tendency to forget, but God doesn't. God remembers that place you knelt and what you said. And you know what? He's going to hold you to it because he has something in store for you. Don't resist the conviction of God. Don't resist even this message when the Lord is telling you to get on the road. If you've gone off the road, get back on. If you're not in the center, get back on the narrow road. Get back on there. Maybe this is foreign to you. Maybe you never heard anything like this before. The Bible says, whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. You mean they're perfect? No. The word is, it means habitually. In other words, if you're born of God, you're not going to continue in that same sinful lifestyle. There's going to be a change. For his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin habitually, because he is born of God. In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. A person that is born of God turns from sin and strives to live for God. Finally, there are two roads you can take. There's the broad way. Broadway is well paved. Nary a bump in it. It's lighted, well lit, in fact. It's popular. It's somewhat easy for the most part, and it's fun. It's exciting on the Broadway. Everybody's there. There's shouting, there's dancing, there's all kinds of partying down the Broadway. The only problem with that is it leads to destruction. The only problem with that is it leads to death. It leads to hell. Eternal separation from God. Oh, it's a Broadway, and it's a smooth way, and it's exciting and fun, and it's popular, but it ends in tragedy. There's another road. Oh, it's narrow. I can assure you it's narrow. And there are no plans in heaven's kingdom to broaden it. And there's potholes, and there are obstacles on a regular basis. And there are curves, and it's sometimes dark, sometimes not well lit at all. And often it's lonely. Sometimes there's nobody else there. And you're on the road again, and there's all kinds of noises and all kinds of voices screaming at you, wishing your demise. And it's not always pleasant, but that road leads to eternal life. That road leads to the narrow gate where Jesus on the other side says, well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter in to the rest that I prepared for you from the foundation of the world. So friends, here's the choice. Which road? I mean, you can enjoy life and just and party on the Broadway, or you could strive. Make no delay, make no avoidance. If you're not on that road, and if you're not in the center of that road, then Jesus says, make no delay in getting there, and do it immediately, and do it constantly, and stay there. It's narrow indeed, but it leads to eternal life. The choice is yours. Would you pray with me as we close? Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I'm so very grateful for the narrow road. Lord, I'm very grateful for the gate at the end, for the gate of life. I'm so thankful, Lord, for what you've promised us in eternity. You're going to wash away all our sin. You're going to wipe away every tear. Lord, we'll stand in your presence. We'll serve you. We'll reign with you forever. God, I'm so grateful that it's not up to us in our own ability or strength. And we can't strive or fight to earn it, but it's a free gift. That Jesus has come to give us this gift of life and abundant life and eternal life. Thank you, Lord, that if we will hear your word and believe on the one who sent you, if we'll confess our sin, you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord, I ask today as we bow in your presence that this word, this message would burn in our hearts, that it would echo in our minds. I pray, God, first of all, perhaps for anyone here who doesn't know you. They're on the broad road. They're on the only road they've ever known. There's the fun and excitement and the pleasures of this world, but it leads to destruction. They live with guilt and they live with shame, and they don't have the assurance of salvation this morning. God, I pray that you would speak to them, that you would show them that only through Jesus Christ, and only by acknowledging that you've paid the price for them, they could have eternity. I pray, God, that you would bring conviction and you would draw them to Christ. I pray also, Lord, for the child of God who's tried to broaden the road, or Lord, who's tried to test the boundaries. I pray, God, in Jesus' name, that you remind them that the road is narrow, that holiness is it's just not an option. It's imperative, because we won't see you without it. God, I just pray that you would remind them of what you've called them to, and that they would strive, Lord, to enter in at the straight gate. I pray, Father, that you would just speak to all of us and show us what you want us to know and what you want us to do today. I pray, God, that you will move in this place right now. As our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, just let me ask you this one thing. Are you here this morning having not given your life to Christ? You've never said, Lord, I need a Savior. I need my sins to be forgiven. Lord, please forgive me of my sin. Please forgive me, Lord. I want to live for you. I want the promise of everlasting life. And I surrender, Lord. I confess my sin. I'm a sinner. And I confess my sin to you, Lord. You already know it. But I pray that you forgive me of my sin and put me on that road that leads to eternal life. If you're here this morning and that's you, would you just raise your hand and let me pray with you? Jesus, I want to confess my sin to you. I want to be forgiven of my sin. Yes. Is there someone else? I want to be a child of God. I want to be forgiven of my sin. I want to live for you. Pray, Lord, that this message would not return void. If there's anyone struggling with this, Lord, I pray that they would strive today against the flesh and against every voice of the enemy that would try and stop them. They would come to that place, God, of surrender to you. I pray for every child of God that's here, Lord, that you would strengthen and encourage, and Lord, that you would draw each of us to an altar of dedication, to an altar of rededication. That you remind each of us, Lord God, that our sins, though they be as scarlet, they'll be as white as snow. That you have forgiven us, Lord. You have separated our sin as far as the east is from the west. Pray, Lord, that you'll just bring that confidence today and that assurance. Lord, let this day be a glorious day for each person that's here this morning, that we would come clean with you and that we would go on from this point in victory. But God, I pray that you would help each of us, regardless of how we came in, that when we leave, we will be walking center of the road. And we ask, God, that you be glorified in each of our lives. For this we ask in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We're going to sing as we go. God bless you. I pray that you would contemplate this message this morning, and I encourage you to come back tonight. Continue with the study of Revelation 17.
Would you stand? You are friends who don't know Jesus as of yet. Let him change your heart to the believer. Maybe once you go deeper, let him change your heart to bring you closer to him.
Hold me and make me.
great and blessed afternoon.